Turning trash into treasure is exactly what Julie Church and her organization Ocean Soul are doing. Their whimsical animal sculptures and jaw-dropping accessories, all made from discarded flip-flops, are nothing short of fascinating and guaranteed to make anyone want to come close and touch it just to be sure whether it's real or a hallucination.
On this exciting episode, join me, Babu Biko,
and myself, Emmanuel Mugo,
as we step into the world of Ocean Soul and see just how plastics are ravaging our oceans and how Julie Church and her organization are in the business of treasure making, all the while saving the planet, one flip-flop at a time.
All this and more right here on Brand Plus TV. This is Into Industries.
Every new day, millions of products are brought into existence, all as a result of the hard work and resilience that people put into their work and product.
In tonight's episode, we look at Ocean Soul, a flip-flop recycling company. The organization is highly passionate about the environment, the ocean, its ecosystems, and marine wildlife. They have therefore endeavored to recycle flip-flops that are found littered on beaches and in waterways of Kenya and have made jaw-dropping sculptures from them.
Biko.
Nice to meet you, Julie Mugo. Nice to meet you. Welcome to Ocean Soul and at Marina Studios.
Thank you so much for having us.
I know, Mugo, you want to meet Maureen.
Yes, I should be going around and maybe try and come up with my own carving.
Okay, great. We'll have fun.
Okay, so while he goes to meet, maybe you and I can have a sit down a bit to talk about Ocean Soul.
Yeah, sure.
All right, let's go this way. Thank you so much for joining us, Julie. And we begin, why don't you tell us a brief introduction about yourself and your area of expertise.
My area of expertise is in marine conservation, which led me to setting up Ocean Soul as a social enterprise. I have a passion for the environment, for sustainability, and particularly, you know, trying to use a trade-based model to lead to, I don't know, better business, so that we don't make such an impact on the environment.
So how did Ocean Soul start?
The concept started when I was in the field, working for KWS and WWF, managing a marine protected area. And while we were trying to conserve the turtles, I saw all this waste coming up, and turtles come to nest on the beaches, and the hatchlings have to go to sea. And the communities were also killing the turtles for their meat and their eggs. So how could we match the two? And the answer came from the children, because they made their toys from waste. So it was a way of giving the communities maybe income by getting them to make things that we could sell and then connecting them to conserving the turtles. So that's where the concept started. In terms of a business, I set this up with my founder, Tarini Bonali, and our idea was that the communities would make things and we would help sell them in Nairobi. And that was about 10 years ago now. But then, you know, this little idea kept growing, kept expanding, it kept evolving. And now we're a business where we started with, you know, that concept of the communities making product to having a few, like six people in Nairobi, sort of adding up, you know, making a few other things, to now we're a team of about 50. So when I started, I had no idea that we were going to, you know, be this big or a social enterprise to the level that we have become and to the level that we can continue to grow.
The brand name Ocean Soul, what was the inspiration behind it?
I think through a lot of exploring, you know, you think about, it's about the ocean and it's about shoes. So it was sort of, instead of S-O-U-L, it was S-O-L-E for the shoes, and obviously ocean, connecting people through the shoe to the sea. I think Ocean Soul inherently is a social enterprise. Mm-hmm. You almost have two parts. You have the commercial part, which is selling which is, you know, selling products that we've made from waste flip-flops. And then you have the impact side, which is like, how many flip-flops have we recycled? How many people have we employed indirectly or directly? How many, you know, how much have we done to help conserve the ocean? But the two are really inherently together. So this is run, you're measuring the impact, and this is really measuring trade and making sure that there's money coming in to keep the sort of cycle going.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about the global reach of OceanSoul?
Well, we're really lucky because I've had a lot of press and articles over the years. So that gives us a huge global outreach. UNEP, the executive director of UNEP the other day in November when the Pope came, gave him one of our extra large elephants as a, you know, as an issue of marine debris and conservation. So that was really cool.
Your Holiness, this is a very special elephant. You know, for Africa, conservation of wildlife is very important, but pollution is also a big problem. This elephant is made by Kenyan business who collect the plastic waste on the coast and make it into these sculptures. So this is the gift that I hope will accompany you on your very important journey through life. Thank you. Thank you so much.
And we're exporting widely. I mean, I think pretty much we're 85% to 90% export. And, you know, so our market and our export market is the States, it's Australia, it's Dubai, it's Singapore, Europe, France, Germany, Sweden, the UK. So we're quite a broad outreach. We can still grow, but we're quite broad at the moment.
And seeing as to how this is such a big operation, how are you able to keep all the moving parts, you know, moving fluidly?
There's no other way without a good team. With a committed team, especially at management, who've been very dedicated, who then we've got a great, you know, production team. At the end of the day, you know, the team are the greatest asset. They're fantastic. Without them, we don't have the products.
How has the world received OceanSoul when you started and currently?
Initially, they were very sweet, hand-carved concepts. I think quite crude compared to where we are now. And the market's always been very receptive to the concept. And I think what we've managed to do is to have a market that really likes the concept, but also likes the product. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think our challenge has been that we got into, you know, safari animals and art. And I think mainly for Kenyans, that's quite a hard buy. Mm-hmm. I think if we came up with more useful products, household products, products like that, then they would, yeah, there'd be more of a customer base. I think have a very clear, simple idea of what you want to achieve and then start filling in the various parts, you know, because there's a lot to it. I mean, it is a business. Business in itself was already really challenging, but business, doing good business, which is about people, planet, and profits, is also much harder because the three have to be in balance.
Thank you so much for joining us.
With over 220 million of plastic being produced each year globally, according to UNESCO, there has been extensive damage to our marine ecosystems, with plastics being identified as the most common pollutant in the oceans. Sea mammals such as dolphins, seals, and whales have all suffered and perished as a result of being entangled in discarded fish nets, with our fishes being choked to death by various plastics, either by swallowing or being caught up in them. To rub more salt to the wound, these same plastics usually end up washing up on our shores, rendering the beach's aesthetics completely useless, which then adversely affects our tourism numbers, as well as it being a health risk to even you sitting at home having your plate of dinner. Through a process known as photodegradation, whereby UV radiation causes large plastic objects to fragment into smaller pieces known as microplastics, these items usually end up in our food chain, which then adversely affects what we eat.
have been walking in the same way as I did, missing out the cracks in the pavement and tutting my heel and strutting my feet. Is there anything I can do for you, dear? Is there anyone I could call? No one, thank you, please, madame. I ain't lost, just wondering. Round my hometown, making memories afraid. So thick and opaque. I love it to see everybody in short skirts, shorts and shades. I like it in the city when two worlds collide. You get the people and the government, everybody taking different sides.
With the aim of recycling 400,000 flip-flops a year and turning them into masterpieces, OceanSol has set the standard for environmental conservation. When we come back from the break, we'll join Emmanuel Mugo as he takes us through a step-by-step process to see just how they manage to turn trash to treasure. We'll be right back.
Okay, please, you're welcome.
Thank you.
My name is Maureen.
Maureen Mugo.
Okay, so normally what we do is we buy the radius flip-flops from the beach, and then we use them when we make our products.
Okay.
So the person who brought this whole idea of recycling is Julie Church.
Mm-hmm.
She's the founder, and everything began in the beach. So we have a group of ladies who normally pick them from the beach. Then after some point, everything is organized. They are all brought here.
Every day, they're shipped in every day?
After a period of time.
Okay.
They are brought here, and then we normally weigh everything. So after weighing, of course, they have to get paid.
Yeah, of course.
It's kind of a job they've been given.
Mm-hmm.
So they normally come in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
And then from here now, what we do, we always clean up everything here.
Okay, because this is where the cleaning
up goes. Yeah, so this is how we normally clean them up.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first water, normally we use the detergent.
Mm-hmm.
We give them a nice scrub. The ladies here normally do give them a good scrub.
Mm-hmm.
And then they rinse to make sure that the soap is all out.
Mm-hmm.
And then in this last water, always you put the disinfectant.
Okay.
To kill germs and even get rid of the bad smell.
Yeah.
Because you can imagine all the places there.
Yeah.
So then after all that process, normally we have that line for drying.
Oh, that's where they're dried up. Yeah.
So that's where we normally dry them.
Okay. Okay.
So this is where we normally dry everything.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we don't just leave everything here once everything has dried up.
Yeah.
So what we do from this line is we sort them, but according to animal sizes, which you always make.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have the cubes, so we always store everything.
Okay.
So we can have a look and see how we do it.
Let's.
Yeah. So when everything has dried up from here, we normally sort them according to animal sizes, which we make.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the cubes here, we always store them.
Okay.
So now if everything is stored in the cubes, for one, it's easy for us to even see the colors and pick.
Yeah.
It saves our time. And also, it makes it look more organized.
Yes.
So we have bin cards around.
Mm-hmm.
So in that manner, it's even more easier. You don't have to go looking for some specific flip-flops like to make for a certain animal.
Yeah.
Because everything
all
is
sorted,
grouped. Yeah. Oh. So we also have this other form.
Mm-hmm.
We don't only use the flip-flops. So with the form,
mm-hmm.
Okay, from that sound at least,
yeah, it's
it's not spongy, it's not even a mattress, but it's
looks
a foam.
Like mattress, yeah.
We normally get it from the insulation of the refrigerators. So now these ones, we use them when we want to make big animals. Mm-hmm. That's what we normally carve first in the shape of the animal. Mm-hmm. And then we stick all our flip-flops on top.
On top.
So we do that because the foam is light and it normally helps lower the cost of shipping. Because you see, with all these products that we normally make, we don't just sell them here. Mm-hmm. We sell them like all over the world.
Yeah.
When we've carved the animals, what we normally do, we use them inside big animals. So we have examples. Let's see how they do it. So you see, like... this one, when you want to make an animal like this one, we have the foam in the whole body, but not on the legs. Okay. For legs, we just use solid flip-flops because we need stability.
Yeah.
That's why we use only flip-flops. Mm-hmm. And if you try it, it's not that heavy.
It's not that heavy, yeah. It's actually pretty light.
Yeah. So because of the foam, that's why it's light.
Mm-hmm.
And so we consider our customers... That's why we use the foam inside, so that they don't have to pay more money. Because if it was made all out of flip-flops, it eventually it would be very heavy.
Yeah.
So because of the heaviness, you'll have to pay
more.
So that's why we normally... But again, when you make... You see, when you make small ones like these ones... sorry. We don't have to put the foam because this is just a tiny one and it's very light. So we just alternate different colors of flip-flops. We form a block. Then from the block, we just carve the animal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. And then another thing, the colors that you see, we don't paint or varnish anything.
All these are just the colors of the flip-flops, the original flip-flops, yeah?
Wow. Okay. So we don't paint, we don't varnish. Then at the end of it, we also have, you see this?
Yes.
That is our trademark.
Ah, yeah, yeah, the Ocean Soul logo. Yeah.
So generally, this is just, it's in form of a soul, which has been picked from the ocean. Which gives us the name, like the ocean soul,
ocean salt,
what we make.
Yeah.
We use soles of
flip-flops
to make,
discarded
flip-flops to make
products
out of them.
Very creative.
Yeah. So colors are natural. Amazing. Everything is completely recycled.
Mm-hmm.
No paint, no varnish. So this is where we normally do all the carvings.
Mm-hmm.
We have this room. We also have the other room.
There's also another side.
So when somebody is working on something, they have to do it from start until the end. Like the guy who was working on the warthog, he had to do it from first.
From it being a block.
Carving the foam first, then putting all the
parts on
the,
and the
flip-flops
on
top.
Mm-hmm.
And then he carves it a little bit. And then later on, we have machines down there. To make everything smooth.
Okay.
So you work on your animal from start until the end. You don't leave it halfway.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So you do it from beginning until the end. So that's how we normally do all the sandings. Maybe you have a look.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Okay. So once we've done all the carvings, everything is brought to the sanding to make them smooth.
Okay.
So this is how we normally sand all the products.
Mm-hmm.
And every person still works on theirs. So what normally happens, because it's a sandpaper, is the machine just moves, and then you do your sanding.
It's moving
So you because of that friction between machine and the rubber, there is this dust that comes out. So because of that dust, again, you have to clean everything at the end of it. So from sanding, we also have another place where we clean them now at the end of everything.
Ah, okay.
So let's see how they normally do all the cleaning. This is also another place of sanding.
Yeah.
So this
area
is just the same as that way.
Ah.
So when everything is done, everything comes here.
Mm-hmm.
Now again, when we do our cleaning, we have to use the same process. Like we use the detergent in the first water, we rinse. Then in the last water, we always put the disinfectant.
Okay.
And this is the disinfectant that you always use.
Mm-hmm.
It normally varies in color. Sometimes you can have a bluish one, or sometimes you can also have the greenish one, depending.
Yeah. And they don't end up ruining the colors.
No, it doesn't. So you see why those
That's why
are
you
there?
Don't even paint it, I guess.
Yeah, so. Because eventually it comes out very bright. And there is no chemical added. So sometimes like these ones, these have been left here because they had some ish smell. And that is normal because they've been to different places.
True.
So from here what you do, everything is put here to dry.
Okay.
Yeah. So once it has dried up like these ones, everything is just natural. No paint, no varnish. Just natural color of the flip-flop. Yeah.
Then after this, now this is
so after this,
is
this now we can take all our records and then now we can
think whether it's shipped
or
bought.
Sold here.
Shall we
so
take
maybe
a look
from
inside,
here
or
we
maybe...
can see from inside and then you see how everything now looks like.
Okay, let's.
So this is how we normally do all our bidding.
Mm-hmm.
So we have this. Actually, these are recycled from their beads from flip-flops.
Mm-hmm.
So we have this lady. She's Florence, and she can show you more about beading. And we have different people. Like Jonathan is there. If you want to do some carving, you can do some carving over there. So
I can try it out myself, because I broke my...
But you have to be careful.
Yeah. I'll be careful.
It's okay. So maybe you can have a seat here, and with Florence, then you see if you could just start with the beading.
Okay. This is exciting.
Right. So I hope you're going to learn more and you're going to do nice stuffs.
I hope so too.
Okay, enjoy.
All right, thanks.
Okay.
Hi, Florence. Hi.
Atukai, kama ukiandu, tunandikiwa target. Sasa,
unaweza order sasa.
Unaweza fanya kumi kwa siku ama kumi na mbili. Sasa inadependa venye pia shanga. Unajua kuna yenye ukipata ukati, zinatoshana. Sasa hii waipai mtu kazi ngumu. Unashona tu. Alafu kuna zenye ziko na shimo zenye zinaingia haraka. Zingine zinakwama. Venye nimeweka hii.
Oh, ndio sasa ifungwe.
Isindilie. Na unachunga usidungwe.
Isindilie
kabisa.
Naikunja tu, sindio?
Naikunja tu. Naikunja tu hivyo. Alafu mewacha. Kile mchukua zikuwa zote hivyo.
Unafinya sasa hapo ndani, sindio?
Unafinya ukivuruto ukiingiza hapo ndani.
Alafu sasa ni?
Imeingia.
Unifinye?
Umeguza hii slipa sasa
katikati hivyo. Hapa hivyo.
Na isitoke inje.
Hivyo.
Nashona beads, hizi mapata-pata, tunatoa shanga ndani ya kushona beads za mkono, na table mats, na vipuli, tunatengeneza nazo vitu mingi mpaka bakuli hizi za kudekorate nyumba. Nimekuja nikatrainiwa huku, lakini kulingana na venye nimepitia katika maisha, niko creative, haiku nisumbua sana juu. Kuanzia utotoni nimekuwa creative. Nilikuwa naangalia tu na ninajua. Mimi kutoka kitambo venye nilizaliwa, huwa ninaweka kwa roho kuna kitu ngumu. Kama ni ya binadamu anafanya kama mimi siwezi shindwa. Sasa mimi huwa na hiyo roho, hakuna kitu naweza nishinda. Sasa huwa siogopi na ninapenda sana nifanye kazi ya mkono yangu. Kuna kazi mingi nafanya huku mpaka kushona mavikapu. Nikianza kukuja hapa nilikuwa nimekuja kama kushona vikapu. Tukashona vikapu na makaratasi. Sasa hapo hapo tu tunaitwa, tunasimamishwa hivyo hivyo. Sasa nikakuja nikafanya hapa. Naona maisha imebadilika kwangu. Imebadilika zaidi juu nimejua kumbe hizi mapatapata hizi tunatupa kama takataka inatupatia madhara katika mwili yetu. Sasa tunaona katika hii kutupa ikuje itupatie shida. Sisi tunaletewa alafu tunahudumisha usafi. Na tena tunatumia, tena tunauza. Inakuwa ni kitu mzuri. Sasa hata sahi nyumbani siwezi nikatupa hizi maslipas. Itabidi niziweke pamoja hata majirani nawaambia waniweke na kuja nayo hapa ninauzia hawa. Tena napata hela. Sasa ilikuja ikanipatia, nikajifundisha kumbe usione kitu kama nitakataka. Kumbe inaweza kuja ikuwe kitu mzuri. Kitu yenye nilitengeneza ikanifurahisha sana ni kushona kikapu. Juu wakati nilikuja hapa tulikuwa wamama kama 100 na kitu. Sasa wakati tulishona vikapu zetu zikawekwa pale, wakati Julie alikuja, nilileta, tulikuwa tunashona nyumbani kama wiki moja, unalipa vikapu kama tatu, ama ine, venye unaweza. Yeah. Sasa mimi nilikuja na vikapu tatu. Venye zilipangwa pale za watu wote, aliona zangu. Akauliza, hii ni kikapu ya nani? Huyo production manager akamwambia ni mama mwingine. Akamwambia nataka kumuona. Sasa venye tulirudi, nikapigiwa simu, nikarudi. Akaniuliza, wewe ndio umeshona hii? Nikamwambia yeye. Umeshawaishona siku nyingine? Nikamwambia sijawaishona. Akaniambia, na umeshona na mkono? Nikamwambia nimeshona na mkono. Akaniambia nimependa sana. Sasa ilikuwa sasa akitaka ile kitu mzuri kwenda kuonyeshana mahali penye hajawahi uza, ananiambia mimi ndio nishone juu. Nilikuwa ninashona na mkono moja. Huwezi jua kama ni mtu mwingine ndiye ameshona. Utafikiria ni mashine.
Ocean Soul works with over 100 individuals at their workshops in Nairobi, in city slums and in remote coastal areas, providing much needed employment. Their creative team of artisans transforms the discarded flip-flops into all sorts of wild animals. When we come back from the break, we will be talking to more artisans as we learn to carve out our own giraffes. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Kafa, mafundi wa kuchonga, na natumia hizi material, ma flip-flops, kwa kasi yangu. Nijulia tu hapa, hata by the first. Wakati wa kwanza tu nilikuja, ya hata mimi nimeshtuka kupatana na kasi kama hii. Na ndio nikajifunza vile ya kutumia hizi material. Sikuwa ifanya hata ufundi ingine mbele, ama sikuwa na idea. Lakini nilisomea hapa, kajifunza, ndio bado sasa nafanya. Kwangu imenisaidia, ndio skills ninapata, ya ufundi ama uchongaji. Pili pia, ndio napata mapato yangu ya kila siku. Sasa hapo naona imenisaidia. Ndio. Kuna die cut ambayo itatengenezwa. Na huwa tunafinya kwa ile machine uliona ikuku nyuma. Ndio ilete duplicate ama iwe zimetoshana zote,
unaona? Eh, namba zote zinatoshana.
Zote zinatoshana na kurahisisha kazi. Sasa itakuwa uniform, unaona? Sasa hiyo baada ya kuichukua patipati kama hii. Kuna ipans, sema kama hii. Si unaona hii ni kichwa ya giraffe. Lakini ni amido. Sasa unaichukulia alafu na ipans.
Inafanywa na mashine hiyo kazi, eh?
Yeah, sasa hiyo baada ya kunaikata na hii. More pieces and then you glue there. Naitumia glue, ambaye ni contact glue. Sasa unaiapply alafu unaipatia ikauke hizo pieces, unaipress together.
Nikuje na kwa hivi. Tunazaifanya sasa kutoka...
Nasa chukua kisu. Nikuonyeshe venye ya kufanya. Sasa, tunatengeneza twiga. Una hivi nye twiga hiku. Sasa, hapa ni kuanza tukavi, ambaye unaanza na kisu, unaona. Hiyo unaichukua, na ilete ile form kama umeangalia kama... Sasa,
kwangu... Ndwe kujika hivi sasa.
Kwangu sasa...
Unajua ushazoea.
Mimi kwa akili, najua mahali ndaanza. Lakini, kwa mtu kama wewe sasa unafaa uangali, unaanza wapi, atabisha ango.
So, unaikata...
Unaichukua hapo. Sasa, ndi ulete, hiyo round is, Na unaichunga sana kisu juu.
Ni sharp pia,
Sasa, lazima akili yako, concentrate na ile mnyama. Wewe ndio unakata hapo. Tena unakuja saidia mbele.
Hiyo hapa hivi.
Unaichota.
Hivyo.
Unachota hapo.
Vile vile tu nimeokota hapa.
Venye tu nimeokota hapo. Kata kabisa ndio iko hiyo. Nailete juu.
Alafu iko juu.
Nailete juu.
Thank you.
talked to some of the workers, and some of them have been here for years, so clearly you've been helping a lot of people over the times.
Yeah, great.
So maybe a curious question I had, local markets.
Yeah.
How can people access your some of the products that you have?
We've got them in on consignment in quite a few shops around town. Spinner's Web, Langata Link. We're trying to get into Serena Hotels and Sarova. Trying to think where else we've got them, but we do have a whole local network.
Yeah, so yeah. People can access them locally. They're not just meant for shipping.
No, they're not just meant for shipping. And also here, obviously, at Mula Studios. And we are going to be working with Kazuri Beads as well.
Okay.
So we'll have some of our stock in their shops.
Amazing. Mm. Talking about the memorable projects that you've participated in, I read about your life-size mink whale, the giraffe. Could you tell us about
that? Yeah, I can. The minky whale we did some time back, actually.
I think around 2006.
Yeah, it was ages ago.
Yeah.
And we did it in partnership with WSPA, Wildlife Organization. And the whale ended up going on a low loader from here down to Mombasa. It was part of an environment day on the beach. And then it's been housed at Halla Park. I actually went there a week ago to go and find him. And a tree has just fallen on him.
Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry.
But that's after a long time, so it's after 10 years.
Yeah.
And we're just about to re-engage communication with Lafarge and Halla Park to rebuild him.
Wow.
So that's a great thing. And then the twiga, the giraffe, went from here to Rome. And it was part of an ethical fashion show. And then it went to, I think it was somewhere else in Switzerland, Montreux, I think. And then it was in Geneva. And I've got to track him down again. I'm not quite sure where he is.
You should.
But we've made some other big pieces. Mm-hmm. We made some lovely pieces last year for the Singapore Aquarium. We made something for the Pacific Aquarium in America. Big pieces, and last year we also made some unique big pieces for a shopping mall in Spain. Yeah, so we've done quite a few of these big, unique pieces.
So talk to me about some of the trade fairs that you've participated in over the times.
Gosh, well, we did the Smithsonian, it was last year, the year before actually, which was fantastic, because they sponsored two of our carvers to go to the States and participate in the event. And we managed to sell quite a lot of our products, so that was amazing. We've been at all the fairs here in Kenya over the years, the Christmas fairs and some of the mid-year fairs. And actually, we're about to go to Germany at the end of August for another trade fair, which we're being sponsored to go to. We also have been sponsored to go to other ones in Paris and Ethiopia and quite a few. Yeah, so it's great.
So what about the recognition you've gotten so far, like awards, things like this?
We've got awards, sustainability awards from the Energy Globe, sort of like it's a competition. We haven't really progressively gone out there seeking that endorsement.
Yes.
And it's an area that we're working on right now to get ourselves fully recognized, fully socially compliant, so that we can do what we call Ocean Soil in a Box, a copy and paste, and take the solution. I guess we're trying to use this as a solution to a global problem of marine waste and waste. So the more we can develop the model, the easier it is to replicate. But we've got to get ourselves a bit more organized here.
Yeah, true. What are your future expansion plans for Ocean Soil?
Yeah, that's it. We've got to sort out.
Yeah.
Get Kenya a little bit more organized, aim to get some production down at the coast, which is where we started, and it's where I guess my heart is with the ocean and with the communities down there. And then ideally really develop the concept that we can replicate this where there's the problem. You know, there'll be a couple of criteria in terms of, you know, local skills and local job requirements and providing an alternative livelihood to sourcing the material. Is it easy to source? Is there a lot of waste? To, you know, linking it to marine conservation and protected area management and stuff like that. So yeah, so we've got to do that, and ideally, you know, have lots of little ocean soils dotted around the world.
So thank you so much for having us, Julie.
It's very you're very welcome. And it's really inspirational to meet you guys at Brand Plus and what you're doing.
The very essence of Ocean Soul was to have a positive impact and to take responsibility for our environment and our community. The question is, how are you helping protect the earth that has given us so much?
Thank you so much
for having us here. Yeah,
I think
really nice.
You've shown Mongo everywhere.
Yeah.
So this is what I made. Maybe
that's pretty good.
See if I can maybe become a sculptor one day.
Yeah, we might need more. You know, the bigger we grow, the more sculptures we need.
We'll never know.
You know, I'm sure he doesn't steal the idea.
Yeah.
He's patented.
All right, then, Julie. Really nice.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot for choosing us at Ocean Soul.
Take care.
Okay, take care. Bye.